before the court this morning is City of Akron's Jennifer Brown. This party will have 15 minutes in which to present their case. The appellant may reserve up to 5 minutes for rebuttal. If the appellant wishes to reserve that time, please let me know. I'm keeping track of the clock and keep your present passage of time. We are being visually allowed to be posted online, so please try to make that recording as much as possible. We have written briefs and ready to proceed.
Public policy interest in ensuring that the school wasn't Yes.
How would there be any assurance that she did what she's supposed to do, which was to go get treatment, if there was no oversight whatsoever, anything in this case?
That's a great question. So, in practical application, the police did not charge her with possession of the drugs, not knowing if she would be a qualified individual. They should do the same thing with the other charges that are allied offenses. In the event she does not qualify as an immune-receiving individual, then charges can be filed. It's a very confusing law because of that. It's
counsel, would you just briefly explain the law, especially for the benefit of the students here? Because you have to be in treatment within, what, 30 days or something like that?
Yes, that is correct. So in order to be a qualifying individual, Jennifer or someone on her behalf has to call 911 because they believe she's having an overdose. Within 30 days, she has to get assessed and enter a treatment program for drug abuse. If she fails to do that, she's not a qualified individual, and she is then prosecuted for the felony possession of controlled substances and any other crimes that go along with that. She also has to provide this information to the prosecutor upon request. What is happening now, police agencies are implementing this on an ad hoc basis, and it's not consistent. If you look at the news, you saw recently a school board member overdosed on fentanyl. While he was given immunity for the felony fentanyl, he was charged with a minor drug possession offense, marijuana. That flies in the face of the very statute that we're here to discuss today. Is that my bill or is that for school? Did I answer your question, Dawn? The other part of this law that makes it very difficult to apply fairly is the fact that 911 operators are tasked with informing people of this immunity. So had it been Jennifer herself who called for help, if she had asked, am I going to get in trouble, the operator would have to, by law, tell her about the immunity. What is that 911 operator going to say? How does she describe the immunity to this caller? Does she tell her, well, you're immune for using the drugs, but if you've got a syringe there, you're going to be prosecuted for that? That's certainly not the intent of the General Assembly. Yes?
Counsel, you make some good public policy arguments, but the city is saying, well, but this is a legislative problem. This is not a public policy. This is not subject to interpretation. The statute's unambiguous and only applies to the fifth degree felony charges.
Well, Your Honor, the city misinterprets the statute. The statute applies to minor drug possession offenses. And while Section 2925 defines that narrowly, that same section refers to the entire chapter by saying, pursuant to this chapter. Those words bring us back to Chapter 2925 in its entirety, which is captioned Drug Offenses. The drug abuse instruments is a possession offense, it is a drug offense, and it is a minor offense. Drug paraphernalia is a drug offense, it is a possession offense, and it is a minor offense. Neither of those have any meaning unless the person is using the drugs, in this case, heroin. It's not logical to have an overdose immunity that does not actually provide immunity. In fact, in a scenario where Jennifer herself would have made the call and asked the call taker, am I going to get in trouble? And is told, no, you have immunity. So she tells on herself. She's incriminating herself. We cannot have a law and apply it in such a way that it violates your right against self-incrimination. Yes, ma'am.
I'm
5 minutes and 30 seconds. Okay. We'll use my 30 seconds to suggest this. There are three main reasons why this honorable court should find the immunity provided by the General Assembly covers each offense. The offense that led up to the overdose is an allied offense of similar import with the other two offenses. We don't have this type of case anywhere else. Those offenses should also be immune. Number two, the General Assembly sought to save lives. We are in a crisis. The Summit County Executive's Office has declared a state of emergency. This requires extraordinary measures and a very strict interpretation of this statute against the state and in favor of the accused. And in these cases, when we are asking people to tell on themselves and each other with a promise of immunity, we must hold every detail of that law strictly against the state and in favor of these individuals. Thank you.
Committed by a person who qualifies for protection pursuant to this division, B2B. Very clearly, the state legislature had intended for this to be limited only to the drug possession offenses that they defined, which again, denied what the state, what Ms. Brown was convicted of.
But counsel, if you OD on heroin, for instance, which we know that heroin overdoses are at all time high, and the legislature is trying everything in its power, every governmental entity in the state of Ohio, the nation, is trying everything in its power to help prevent these overdoses. So if the goal is to prevent overdoses and to get people help, not charging them with possession of the heroin is one thing, but then to overdose, they have to have some mechanism to achieve the overdose, such as a syringe. And then the city is charging them with possession of the syringe. Doesn't that defeat the purpose?
No, because the purpose is what the legislature intended it to be, which is that it's only for the possession. The legislature did not, if they intended it for it to include other crimes, they would have put it into the statute, and they didn't.
But the purpose of the statute is to help prevent overdoses.
The purpose of the statute is to provide immunity for the people from the overdose. I don't want to read into what the legislature intended was, because when the language of the sense of the statute is plain, you need to apply what is written, and what is written is very clear what its limits are. And to the extent that the legislature intended to do something different, they didn't put that into the statute. And to the extent that they want to change it, they have a mechanism to do it, which is to pass a new law to fix whatever mistake they could have possibly considered to have made. But the language as it is written right now does not provide for immunity to go beyond the minor drug possession offense, which is only the offenses that are in the possession of the drugs that listed in the 2925 code. And at the same time, the addition to the allied offenses, 2941.25 does not actually apply to this case at all, because by its own terms, it's a person cannot be convicted of similar allied offenses of similar import. She was only convicted of one crime. And so 2941.25 does not apply to this, because she was not sentenced for more than one crime. She was only sentenced for
suggests that she shouldn't have been charged with anything, and that wouldn't have brought her case to court at all. And wouldn't that put the police in the position then of having to determine everything about this particular person, whether they're chargeable, whether they're magnificent? The onus that puts on the police to make those decisions in the field is a little. You have to take the overdose person's word for everything.
It would be difficult, Ms. Brown does raise a good point, which is that until they actually enter into rehab, they're not qualified. So in theory, the city should be maybe charging them at the scene then, and then like if they become qualified, they just get some charges. But the solution is not to not charge them, because they at this point they're definitely not immune for everything else, and they may not even be immune for the drug possession itself at the time of the arrest. Also, I wanted to touch on briefly this was raised at the end of the oral argument. The idea of strictly construing this against the state and in favor of the defendant. I believe this argument is coming out of RC 2901.4, which was not, again, this argument wasn't actually raised in the brief. This is not something that the city's had a chance to brief or respond to, and it really shouldn't be, I would argue that they waived it for the purpose of this appeal. Having said that, the statute itself is very clear about what it applies to. The statute says that the statute defines the criminal offense and a penalty will be construed in favor of the defendant. And against the state. First of all, you only get there if the language is ambiguous at all, which this is not. And furthermore, by the language of 2901.104, it does not actually say immunity shall be construed against the state and in favor of the defendant. And I have not seen anything that says that immunity should be liberally construed. Everything I've ever seen is that immunity statute should be strictly construed in favor and not expanded. So, to the extent that they want to make this argument, It's something that the city would ask to have an opportunity to respond to after our argument's over, and so we can fully brief the issue. And just a few, one last point, the issue of how this is being applied and whether it's being applied equally across the board. The idea of, there was a mention of a school board member, that's not on the record, that none of that's in this record before you. Similarly, the idea of the dispatcher, that argument was never raised at any point in these proceedings. This is brand new again, no argument. A significant portion of this has been when the city points out flaws in the argument, new arguments get raised. And so it's one of those things where all these arguments are not fully properly briefed before this court and should not be considered. So in light of this, the city would ask the interpretive request to apply the language of the statute and apply the legislature intent as it is written and find that an appropriate decision on this court. Thank you.
First, I will address statutory construction. There is no requirement of ambiguity. The Ohio Revised Code in section 2901.04, Rules of Construction, simply states that in defining offenses or penalties, revised code shall be strictly construed against the state and liberally construed in favor of the accused, which is in line with numerous cases on constitutional law. In Ohio, that requirement is codified. Having said that, the statute is ambiguous. It's ambiguous as written and as applied. And I'm going to give you a few examples of more illogical results from this statute. As counsel just said in answer to Your Honor's question, the defendant should not be arrested for anything if she's a qualified person for immunity.
But who would make the determination as to whether she's qualified? You're suggesting the policeman needs to make it in the field.
Exactly, Your Honor. That is the problem. That's what's wrong with the statute, one of the things wrong with the statute. The statute says no person shall be arrested. How is a police officer to know whether or not Jennifer is going to get treatment at the moment the officer would make the arrest? I don't disagree with you. That's why this statute is ambiguous and problematic. The other problem, let's say Jennifer had some very popular drugs, fentanyl, heroin, LSD, cocaine, marijuana, all in her hands, on her person when the officers arrived. The only drug she used for the overdose was heroin. Under this current law, the way it's written, she's immune from possessing all of those felony-level drugs. Yet the city would have you believe she's not immune from possessing the needle that she used to take the heroin and the little water bottle cap she used to mix the heroin with water. Those offenses she would not be immune from under their interpretation. That is too complex for the 911 operator to explain to a citizen calling for an emergency. And that is unfair to the people that this law is designed to protect. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you both for your presentations today. The court will take the matter under advisement, issue a written decision, which will be available to both sides and posted to our website as well as at the Supreme Court. The court is adjourned until Tuesday in summer.